To live and die in LA, California. No matter what you say about Los Angeles, still the only place for me. It never rains in the sun. To live and die in LA.
Growing up in LA is one of those things you kind of feel like you're lucky to be a part of it, because everybody look at LA like it's one of the meccas of culture as far as, you know, style and music and things of that nature. You go back to when Boys in the Hood came out and everybody wanted to be like, you know, the people in Boys in the Hood and South Central. Movies like that pay the way. A lot of people wanted to be from LA, so to be born here, I feel like it's an honor to be a part of that culture, naturally, like by birth. As you can see now, we in Watts. You might hear all the stories about Watts, but it's hoods everywhere you go. You know, if you're not looking for trouble, trouble ain't gonna too much find you. And that's what I discovered living in the inner city of LA. My parents kept me in sports. I didn't really get in too much trouble because I was always in sports. I was too busy.
So at a young age, I got Kevin to really involve in running track and playing football. He would go to track practice on Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, and Sunday was the track meet. So he pretty much had no time on his own on the weekend. I come from a family of six boys, and I'm the youngest, and all of us play football.
And then on the other side, you have my mother's side, who all sing.
Every family has something that they're focused on, and in my family, it's always been music.
Even from birth, I kind of had two different paths I could go on, but I was more so pushed towards the sports.
And I could go back when he was a little boy. He really didn't really like football, but you know, I kept encouraging him, putting him in situations where he was going to be, where he was successful. And you know, it worked out that he was able to put athletics and school together and then earn him a scholarship.
The whole college experience was a blessing for me, coming from the inner city, just going to Washington. The demographic is different. It ain't a lot of people who look like me, you know, and I had to get used to that. And it was a blessing to be able to play football on a full scholarship, not have to worry about the bills, expenses. You know, that was a luxury. I liked football a lot, but kind of halfway through, just the politics of it. It made me fall out of love with it. And you know, when you don't love something, you're just going through the motions. You're never gonna be great at it. I feel like everything you do, you need to be great. And I don't think I was gonna be great at football going through the motions when I had music tugging at my heart the whole time.
I told him, you know, you out of school now, you done graduated, you gotta find yourself a job. And he was like, oh, let me think about it. You know, it was to the point that I was like, dude, if you're gonna be that disrespectful, you're gonna get out. So, you know, we had even got together where it came to blows. And, you know, we got out on the front yard, and I'm still dad. I brought you in, I'll take you out.
He, I guess you could say is almost a typical young man who disagrees with his father at times, and because of that, he had to leave the house to recognize that his father is the head of the house. And since I'm grandma, he came here. And I'd rather him be here than out in the street. Yeah.
Sweet lady, would you be my sweet love for?
I didn't really come from much. This is the room where I made Deuces. You know, it's not much. You see the gold boots, you know, root to the cubes. I. That's my fraternity, Omega Psi Phi, best fraternity. You know, this room might not be much, but My granny, she allowed me to make music all night, banging music, waking up the neighbors. You know, that's what I got kicked out of my parents' house for. So, but she let me do it. Thanks. Thanks, Grand Muffin. Deuces. Deuces is a song I came up with, part of it, in my sleep. I was dreaming. In the dream, I'm leaving a big auditorium, and I hear the song playing, and I heard the say bye-bye, I heard that part. So I got up immediately, and I had just made a beat directly the night before, and all it had was just a... Just had that with an 808, and I liked it raw like that with not a lot of music to it. And that's when I wrote the rest of the verse. As soon as I woke up, I wrote all the verses. I wrote my first verse, and I wrote a rap verse. And I recorded it all in one sitting. It took me about 3 hours. And that same day, I liked it so much, I posted it on YouTube and Facebook, and it got a lot of good feedback. But not anything close to the magnitude it got once Chris and Tiger got on it and put their magic to it, and it became a whole nother record.
Look, my shorty always on some bullshit like Chicago, so I flip that middle finger and the index finger follow.
We ain't got no future and tomorrow. I'm a team, so it shouldn't be that hard to swallow. Look, the chick I would never complain. Make me wanna be the one I'm with, Usher Brain.
With Chris, we've came out with Ain't Think About You, featuring Bow Wow. I got one on Carrie Hilson's album, One Night Stand. I got one on Last Train to Paris, Yesterday. You know, just countless others. Placement stuff that's top secret. You have to keep on the lookout for it. And my mixtape coming out Valentine's Day. Hopefully that'd be a classic alongside Fan of a Fan, In My Zone 1 and In My Zone 2. I just appreciate Chris allowing me the opportunity on this last mixtape to have features, so people really seeing my artist side. And they already know me from behind the scenes, but he's the type of dude, he doesn't hate on nobody. I mean, what's for one man is for that man, so he understand, you know, if I start shining, he wants to help me shine, you know, and my goal is to just, you know, take that opportunity and make the best of it. CBD.
Whole lot of sex, yeah. Whole lot of liquor, yeah. Whole lot of chicks, not a lot of nickels, right. Not my body, it's all about the bitch, yeah. Sexy model miss, yeah. Hands like this.
I think K-Mac is gonna be something unique, you know? There's not a lot of people who are so multi-talented and also, like, you know, they don't have to be around any other producer or writer or rapper to make their music, so that's special. And I think K-Mac has like that incredible potential as far as he has number one hits already. He wrote on No Bullshit With Me. He did Deuces, produced it, and wrote with it. He already has that clout under his belt from doing that. But I think his solo stuff is just gonna show you more of his talent and what he has to bring. Like, a lot of his music is incredible. Like, for the women, I know those girls are gonna really like a lot of his grown stuff because he's more grown and sexy for the women, and more of that real R&B. He has like the best of both worlds, because, you know what I'm saying, girls want to mess with him, and the niggas fuck with him.
I've always been the type of person who refuses to be put in a box. So for someone to say you can only sing, or you can only rap, or you can only produce, my goal is to, you know, defy that law, to break that rule. I like to think of myself as, the best way I could put it is probably a modern day Lauryn Hill, a male version of Lauryn Hill. I rap, but I also sing soulfully. It's a difference between singing with the auto tune and, you know, singing straight. You know, it's nothing against that. I like that too, but I grew up singing in a church. I grew up off the Clark Sisters, Smokey Norville, Daryl Coley, Kim Burrell, all those great people, Jay Moss. You know, I'm a real soulful singer, and but I also can rap.
I make you run and tell your friends, I'm Ricky, I'm it.